ప్రసన్న వెంకటాచార్య చిత్రవేద స్వామి వారి కరికమలాలతో
శ్రీమతే రామానుజాయ నమః. In the process of intellectual civilization of mankind, which you call as epistemology, human being has two major skills. One is the skill to conceive, second is the skill to execute. And the standard or gravity or depth of these two skills of conception and execution, that differs from person to person. And that which is ephemeral, that is a transient, that which is limited by a time, limited by a concept, or demarcated by means of a depth, are limited only few members of the society. So these are all the various type of parichedas, what we call in Sanskrit, that which is can be dealt with only some area, that which can deal only with a few people or a few corners of the society, that which is time oriented, that which is benefit oriented, only within a limited guardians. So this is what we call paricheda, that which is limited with person, time, value, province, etc. So that which exceeds the beneficial components being demarcated within the barriers of time, space, person, limitation, benefit scale, etc. That is said to be sublime conception and sublime execution. So that which caters to the need of a mass, that which has perennial sever and perennial supply of benefits, and that which has a multifaceted and multidimensional execution and benefit, that which reaches all corners of the society, that which gives a deep way of probe and thinking and bestowal in the society, that is said to be sublime, reaching all members of the society and deep rooted inside their minds, giving a very valuable benefit and penetrating into the society for longer generations and periods. So durability, value, mass and gravity of the reach, everything is distinct in a sublime order. That's why we used to say two special words are coined exclusively for considering the highest or the saturated or the culminated states of thought as well as culminated state of action. Everybody they thinks and everybody they acts, but all thoughts and all acts cannot be equivalently or equipotentially gauged. They are having their own variations. So the most culminated status of a person's thinking, we used to call it as a vision. Vision is also a type of imagination. It is a dream, it is a conceptualization, it is a visualization, it is a speculation, it is a program of thinking. It is also the same thought process. So whenever a person immediately thinks something out of an instinctive outburst, out of the inclination of a person's emotional and sensational proclivity, any person can start about thinking anything. So this is very thing like a lightning that has no hold, that has no charge, that has no transformation, that is no having conductivity, and that is not having any productivity at all. That which has a hold, that which has a conversion, that which has a storage, that which has a potential transformation, conductivity and productivity, that is going to be a great character or a great attribute. So thought is something which lies in a very common member of the society. It is the inseparable instinct of any neurobiological sense. It is a very common happening. Any person or any human being, within the credentials of his nature being a human being, he can think. So the lowest profile of human thinking is known as thought, and the highest profile is known as vision. The lowest profile of a human execution is known as action or function. The highest profile is known as mission. So that which is in the thought level in the highest standard is known as vision. That which is in the execution in the sublime level is known as vision. So vision is the instigating spirit. Just as there is an igniter, in a gas stove there will be an igniter. A spark of the ignition, already compressed combustible gas that is operated, that is instigated, that is promulgated, that is properly attuned by means of an igniting spirit, that bombards into a bomb, or that lights into a lamp, or that furnaces into your process of metal casting, or exhibits in the form of a flame in which you can cook, depending upon the contextual barriers. Likewise, vision is the igniting spark. And if a person is having a vision in the form of an igniting spirit, then that will lead to a mission, a proper way of practical or technological implanting or implementation of the same vision to reach the goals. So now what we need for the society is not a thought or a plan, not an action or execution. What we need is we want visionaries and missionaries. Only visionaries and missionaries, they can take things out of their hearts, out of the auditorium, out of the school, out of the offices, out of the parliaments, and out of the centers of discussions and debates. Now everything is inside. Lot of people are having lot of concepts, but everything is captivated inside. They are all chained, they are all caged, they are all confined and captivated inside the minds and buildings. Everybody, they are reading about ethical, moral and spiritual principles and their implementation. What is the problem? That is inside the cage of the academic campus. That does not drive out at all. And in offices, they are discussing about professional morale and other things. In parliaments, they are debating about national issues. So everything that they carry, either lot of the good people they are carrying inside their hearts, or all of the unscrupulous elements they are carrying just in speech and within confined compounds, not being given the liberal breeze to inhale for those principles so that they can permeate in the society. That is the problem. So what we want is a vision and mission. You must not ask me whether I am a visionary or missionary. I am there to tell about the concept. As it is a global work, as it is a teamwork, as it is a national work, we are all the different types of people setting up fire in all of these places, not the fire which destroys the roof of the hut, but it is a Gyanagni, it is a Tapagni, it is a Pavitragni, which is going to totally extirpate the unwanted evils of the society and installing in the essentialities that could build a future society, which is a fortune society, and which is a futuristic society with all resources in fullness, just as we have had in our ideal state before. And let us start with the tools of mission. Mission means it must have four tools. One is ideology, and second is necessity, third is leadership, fourth is participation, as per the science. And the first thing I have already told, that it is ideology. What is ideology? Taking a particular thing is known as idea. I want to achieve this thing, that is known as idea. And you totally consummate, pop-plenary, fulfilled, full-fledged, multi-faceted, multi-dimensional approach to the positive and negative factors for an idea, for accomplishment, for acquisition, for achievement and implantation, that is known as ideology. Ideology is a systematic understanding of an idea. For example, for hunger, immediately I can say, what is the only solution for poverty? Then money. And what is for hunger? Food. Yesterday, we delivered a lecture on therapies. I told that the effective therapy is money therapy. Give money to all people, immediately they will smile. Even the other therapies, they will make them laugh or to be comforted after a few weeks. So we know the solution for everything. Don't we know the solution? We know the solution. We have problems in implementation because of lack of integrity and other problems which we are going to discuss later. The first thing is, idea anybody can make. That's why great people say, ideas can be made by even fools, but ideology can be executed only by wise. I want to get money to drive away poverty. We want to increase more food productivity for eradicating hunger. We want to increase employment sources for developing youth initiatives and for lessening youth participation in unwanted activities, immoral activities and disruptive activities. So these are all the various things. Everybody knows the solution. Don't we know the solution? If we get the question paper, immediately we can pass in the examination. So we know all the answers for our questions. But what is the problem? Number one, what do you want? How much do you want? For whom you want? How much do you want and how much you have for getting those things? What are all the hindering factors? What are all the supporting factors? What is your circumstantial and environmental cooperation and disruption? So everything is dealt in ideology. If you want to get a thing, what are all the supportive factors? What are all the clarifications of that idea? That is known as the ideology. So we have to develop an ideology which has a holistic study of all of the concepts. If you want to implant, those things are not customized. Bringing back peace in Hyderabad is different from bringing back peace at some other area. For example, Chhattisgarh, there is some problem. Jammu Kashmir, there is a problem. So there are a lot of problems on various areas. They are based on different sensations. We cannot have generalized study. There is a generalized dimension and also a customized dimension. So ideology, that gives you proper idea of how you can tackle that issue pertaining to that area, pertaining to that mental setup of people with this type of tools. If you want to say, I want to travel, then that is idea. when do you want to travel? If it is winter, Napoleon's army that went to Siberia at the time of winter. So we want to see also the environmental conditions. When you are going to have that travel, and with which vehicle you are going to travel, for what purpose you are going to travel. On the basis only we can say when you can exactly reach and how much your voyage or travel can be benefited. So it is ideology, it is a systemic study of what you want, supportive factors, circumstantial factors, disruptive factors, and tools or promoters of supportive factors and supporters in the society for the disruptive factors. All of these seven units are totally studied in ideology. And ideology emerges in sociology. Human beings, they grouped to form society. Collective society, integral society, federal society. Collective society in the form of clans, castes, everything, etc. They made integral society in the form of nations and provinces. And various other expanded global network. Now we are having universal brotherhood and universal fraternity. And we are having a global village system. It is known as a federal type of these things. When society emerges, then immediately necessity boosts. The first emergence ideology is known as social ideology. When society emerges, lot of people, lot of needs. So they have to implant lot of methodologies, technicalities and tools for giving out the possibilities of exploration and scrutiny of the resources. I want to live. I want to have a better life. I want to have a comparatively better life. Better life is of two types. My life better than him is personal comparative. My life better than what it was yesterday is temporal comparative. So this betterment is straight going on in the pursuit of human being. So a lot of resources are exploited, explored, experimented and extravagated. All of these things result in economy. First society, society results in economical development. Whenever there is a resource, then the mind becomes the culprit. When a person is free from an opportunity or free from a circumstantial urge to commit a blunder, error, mistake, sin, offense, crime or error, at the time the person is totally free. He is a non-opportunistic criminal or innocent. Non-opportunistic in psychology or criminology we should say they are non-opportunistic criminals or non-opportunistic innocents. So the innocence has not been well exploited by the circumstances to boost the person to go into an offense. At that time only there are two systems which evolved. One is the moral evolution, second is the spiritual evolution. First human being evolved, that is biological evolution. Then they grouped together, that is social evolution. When they grouped, they explored the richness and resource of the society for their utility, development and sustenance. Then it resulted in economical development. When economy results in resources, time sharing, power sharing, you are here, taratamya. Great and less, good or bad, you or me. So the ego clashes. That is also an unavoidable growth or unavoidable factor or component in the era of civilization, which has resulted in two major systems for control. One is a political system which established the morality in the society by means of justice. And second is a spiritual system which provoked the inner conscience to make the person rule themselves, control themselves, by means of which divine justice is established. So this is ideology. So now we are going to deal with four systems, all the four systems. What is the sociological evolution of India? And what is the economical evolution of India? And what is the political system which governs the morale? And as well as the instinctive conscience which is governed by the spiritual renaissance or revolution made by the greatest seers, saints and implanters of the society, morale and spiritual realization. So this is known as ideology. The second thing is, no doubt it is a research oriented topic and it cannot be sweetened by interesting stories, analogies and diversions. This is a serious thought and we are inside a problem. And we are inside a problem for our future, in which our generations may suffer, our great country may suffer. So it is a subject of seriousness, it is a subject of severity, it is a subject of sturdity and stolidity. So we have to see that how far we can go for a proper way of venture by which we can pray for it, we can perform for it, we can work for it, we can plan for it, we can execute with collective minds. The second thing is necessity. There are four necessities in the society. Necessity arises when there are four situations. Number one, whenever there is a deterioration for the essential energy. Second thing, whenever there is a counter appropriation of the other side energy. Paritranaya sadhuna vinashaya chadushkrita. So like that, the first thing says that the deterioration of the essentialities of the society. The second thing, over appropriation or it is misappropriation or counter appropriation of the other side. The third thing is a tumultuousness in the society, a great calamitous situation in the society. Fourth thing is inertia, nothing is moving. So whenever good thing is reduced or bad thing is more in proportion, or the society creates a very chaotic base, or the society is neither having good or bad, it is lifeless and it is inert, then we have to raise our spiritual energies. Now we are having counter appropriation and we are slowly reaching tumultuousness. This is not the stage of necessity for our country according to this scientific, computer, technical, nano era, whatever they call in science. So this is a necessity. Third thing is leadership. Each and everybody, they have a servant inside and they have a leader inside. So a leader has a perfect servant quality and a servant must have a leadership quality to instigate his followers. So each and everybody must have a component which has to rule themselves and to be subservient to their predecessors and also to teach and create subservience to their successors. So this must be a simultaneously existing bilateral and bivalent component in each and every leader. So leaders, they have the hierarchy into five major member groups. One is the leader, second is the team, third is the commander, and fourth is the soldier, fifth is the subject. So it must start with a leader who is the unifying spirit. Who is the leader? Leader is different from a carrier. Any person without having the mind, the potence, the compassion, the radiation to pronounce such a verdict by which you are united, by the qualities of oratory, by the qualities of sacrifice, by the quality of brotherhood, by the quality of affecting, affectionate, radiative splendor by which he is altruistic and all-encompassing, cosmopolitan in nature, that is known as leadership. And any person with his fame in media, any person with his just literary and oratory skills, any person by show and projection and image construction technology in the society, those people, they are not leaders. They are carriers of the society as per their norms. They are carrying the society, they are miscarrying the society, they are alluding the society so that they can use the society as a tool to benefit themselves. So, carrier is a person who takes the benefit of the society for his growth, whereas leader is a person who sacrifices himself, who uses himself as a tool for the growth of the society. So, leadership is the first thing. Second thing, a leader cannot immediately execute something. He needs a proper team. So, a leader is more blessed and fortunate only if he has a team. If there is only one person in a drama or in a company where the other person, all other persons are Paramananda, Shishyalu or Kauravas, then how can he run the company or run the show? They will be either foolish or they will be totally against you. So having a supportive atmosphere, the team is also a blessing. Third thing, commanders, those who are going to propagate. All people, they establish only like that. Germany, if you see Hitler, if you say Mussolini, if you say Karl Marx, if you see political systems, religious systems like ISKCON even, everybody, they spread only by a leader. Chaitanya was a leader and there was a team for Chaitanya, and now propagator or the promulgator or the commander was ISKCON Prabhupada. Now you see Prabhupada is a leader now for the contemporary ISKCON society, and there are a lot of people in the team work, there is a committee. Now there are commanders, now there are soldiers selling the books, giving interpretations by various means, commercial approach, literary approach, knowledge approach, service approach, then personal counseling approach, innumerable psychological, intellectual, social connectivities are there. They are now there. Then subjects are the sheep, the flock of sheep, the society who bothers about anything or who bothers about something which is not to be bothered or who does not bother about something which is to be bothered or who bothers about everything. So these are all the members of the society and they must be bleached with, they are being bleached with brainwashing element. So we want them to be bleached by blind faith and blind pathway. They are being brainwashed by the people. We want a blind faith in brain energizing systems, not in brainwashing systems. The same blind faith and blind practice must be incorporated in a system which is brain energizing system, not washing system. So everybody, they have this panchayudha or panchavayava, which is known as a leader, a team and a commander and soldiers, committed soldiers and subjects. This is how you have to create India's mission, not by speeches, oratory, publication of pamphlets, everything, etc. These are all the parts of these things. Then what are all the maximum participation possible? One thing is instigating. You can provoke others. Nourish. If somebody is already provoking, you can just nourish them by means of your physical, mental, financial supports. And the third thing is supportive. You can totally participate and render your life. Fourth benefit is, fourth participation is very simple. It is non-maleficence. If you don't disturb them, they will flourish at all. The fourth thing is advesha. Advesha, we used to say in Shastras also, what to do to attain God. The first requisite is advesha. You need not have any priti. If you are having non-maleficence, that itself is a very great reward. That is an ornament for attaining God. Likewise, we must not be, at least even though if we are not ready to be beneficial, we must be non-maleficial. So these are all the various qualities or various pillars of mission. Now let us have a very, very brief look upon the requirements of a mission. Number one, a strong commitment. Dhriti, what we call. A strong commitment. Number two, You must be having staunch belief in what you are going to teach others. The third thing, you must have a penetrative power by which you can create the belief in the other person's minds. Number four, no compromise. There are four compromising factors in the society. Even great people, even great workaholic people, even great integral people, laborious people, diligent people, painstakingly effort-taking people, they will be lost at a moment. There are four factors of compromise. One is avarice. If some benefit is there visibly or visually somewhere else, immediately these fellows will shift. Fear, if they are threatened, tension, threat and terror and turmoil. These things are various tools which will make the person to be collapsed and dismantled, by which the person will leave his mission. Then he will say that leaving this mission itself is his mission. Then the other thing is, third thing is ego. Even lot of people, they are in good mission, because of ego clashes, they are also going to do the same good. If the same good is performed by somebody else, immediately that ego is spirit that will be awakened inside, and that will prevent them either to grow by themselves or allow that person to grow. So this type of egoistic activity, that is also a hindering factor. And the final thing is frustration. There is no end for trial in spiritual things, even in any things, national. For example, when Indian War of Independence started and when we got independence, if those fellows, they would have their personalities, their great personalities, if they were frustrated, then would have we got this freedom of independence and would be been respiring or inhaling the breeze of liberty now? No. Frustration must not be there. Good things may happen at their own time and instance. So we may not be limiting this as per your desire, and you must not be frustrated, but instead of which you must be boosted more to perform and get that. So you must be devoid of these four compromising forces, and you must be non-compromisable, uncompromisable. The fifth thing is, that is the problem with great people. They are all great people, but they don't leave great people behind them. Due to which after their demise, then it becomes a problem to the society. It is known as successor breeding. What is it? Successor breeding or succession breed is a quality of good, eminent and capable system of mission, wherein by they leave equivalent or even hypervalent personalities like them, so that even after their departure, the continuity will not be arrested. That is the fifth thing. And the final thing is, even though the continuity, because they are doing something and that must not be hindered by their departure or demise, even though they are out of the system, even though they are out of the world, still it must exist. The final thing is, he must be a model for his ideal. Then only that impression or that impact on the society can be made. So a good mission must have six qualities. One is ability to impact others, having staunch belief, strong determination, uncompromisability, succession breeding, and being a model for his own ideal. What are all the practical difficulties in bringing mission? Number one, the people trend changes by century. Decade by decade it changes. In taste, in food, in music, in office, in house, in behaviors, in social behaviors, in commitments, in love, affection, in each and every unit of their life, their trend is being changed. So they are not having any uniformity. So this trend of change, if you adopt something today, if the same mission exists, after 10 years it will not work, because the trend of the people change. So you must update also yourself towards the changing trend, and you must update your systems and modify them so that it can reach. So it is something connected with changing of trend. Second thing is a very big problem. It is post-acquisition dilution. It is a very good phenomenon which has not been properly understood. Post-acquisition dilution is, India got freedom. Till getting freedom, the zeal that was present with all the members of the society, after getting the freedom, it was diluted. That is known as post-acquisition dilution. They wanted to drive, they did not think about the possibilities of Indians behaving worse than that British colonization. They did not think about the political system which will be more corrupted. That's what the great people in Great Britain, told about the great India. We are going to hand over the country and they are going to suffer. That's what they told. So it is post-acquisition dilution. If you acquire something, you must have two things. Whatever we have acquired, that must not be reappropriated by somebody else. That must not be diluted or diversified. These two things we have to get in our memory and vigilance, that was lost in the society. Whatever they get, they think that that is the last scene, that is the epilogue. They think that that will be permanent and perennial, and they used to get all of their vigor, potency, everything diluted. Just as any person who is doing a very hard task, he will feel himself fly with wings. Likewise, the great struggle of the freedom psychologically created a deeper impact in the minds of the Indians that they have become too lazy, too impotent, too imbecile, too disorganized after the freedom of independence. It is a psychological term which has not been properly undertaken for research by most of the people. It is post-acquisition dilution in psychology. That is the second reason. Third thing is group politics. There are two types of group politics. One is power share. Who will share the benefit? Second thing, even though they don't share the benefit and they work for the society, ego clash, frequency mismatch. So this thing also very much affects the society, and this is also to be extirpated. And the final hindrance, the first hindrance, it is the changing of the trend. Second thing is post-acquisition dilution. And the third thing is power clash or frequency mismatch within the communities. And the final reason by which we cannot develop these societies because lack of commitment and lack of proper organization between the group people, which has resulted in the total turmoil of the society. Now let us come to century. We are talking about the century. What are the various supportive factors and what are the negative supportive factors? Positive supportive factors and negative supportive factors for the century so that India can achieve something. One is transportation. We are having transportation facilities. Before that, if you want to reach some place, it would have taken months and years together for travel and come back, if possible. So, transportation. Second thing is communication. There are communication tools by which we can immediately contact any person at any corner. The third thing is liberalization of knowledge. You are having a lot of books, you are having a lot of universities, you are having a lot of palm leaf scripts now transcribed into book forms. Everything is available in net, world wide web, www, everything you are going to see. And this is also having a dark complexion in the sense that as it has been liberalized, everybody started interpreting, everybody started informing, everybody started writing books. So it has become this global monopoly which has been liberalized, and it has deep felt into the process of introduction of all unwanted elements, so that now we have to be in the process of selecting or segregating the particles of rice from the stones. Now, before that, rice was there and that was put in stock and sealed. Now we are having rice in abundance. Now we have been given an opportunity to isolate the rice particles from the sand particles or stones. Now everything is mixed because of this liberalization. Fourth thing is, science has given two benefits or betterments. What are the two betterments of science? One is demystification of the world. Second is magnification of the world. Whatever the things we thought that they are great, science has proved that this is nothing. So we are demystified. Second thing, whatever we thought to be small, the science has magnified. So science has magnified this world, which will urge for us to know about the creator, to know about the system and complexities. So transportation is very accessible now. We are very affordable to all systems of knowledge. So more possibilities for spreading our knowledge, our heritage is possible now. Because the world has been magnified, God has been understood more. The world's richness and depth has been now promulgated by means of textures, by means of research articles and demonstrations, by which a deep probe into God, necessity for understanding the fundamental element, that has also been enriched. The fifth thing is multi-level education system or multi-level analytical system or multi-knowledge processing system. Now, you see, whenever somebody is denied, then at the time of denial, the depth will be evolved. For example, if you ask me to speak, I will speak only 10%. If a person is asking with a doubt, then he will answer 20%. If the person is asking with enthusiasm, I will answer 50%. If a person strongly is against my speech, I will evolve my 100% of knowledge with all the factorial grounds to prove myself. The more we are doubted, the more we are analyzed, the more we are approached with enthusiasm, the more that we are confronted, then the more hidden dimensions are revealed. Likewise, there are a lot of atheism, communism, skepticism, socialism, materialism, nihilism, pantheism, pseudo-theism, pseudo-spiritualism, etc. and etc., which has totally diluted the spiritualism, which has resulted in the evolution of a lot of spiritual personalities to prove themselves. They are bringing a lot of unclear depths inside. So the science has given five benefits. One is the transportation benefit to reach anybody. Second is the communication benefit to reach anybody and correspond. And third is the liberalization by which we can access to source materials. Fourth is magnification facility by which we can learn more about the world and godly context. And the fifth thing is multi-level knowledge processing system, which by skepticism, enthusiasm and antagonism has enriched the depth of the spiritual science, so that we have to prove ourselves by going to the depth. There is no other way. So it has compulsorily, necessitatively, it has made that. So these are all the benefits of this century. Only this century we are having that. If it is before 5 or 6 centuries, we were totally different. If it is even the before century, we were unprocessed. So the baby of the modern century was unconceived before few centuries. It was not undelivered before. It was totally undelivered before a single century. Now it is a delivered baby. It was unconceived before 5 or 6 centuries. In the previous century, it was undelivered. Now the labor is over and now we are at the exact necessity level. And what are the 5 major things that urge us to go for spiritualism? Only India can give the answer. One is bodily health and longevity. Lot of pharmaceuticals, that has somebody has told, about 1.4 million people, they have gone bankrupt only on the case of medical expenses. At United States of America, where there is Harvard University, Stanford University, and various other centers of lower, advanced lower, in spite of which 1.4 million people, they have gone bankrupt. So these growing diseases, uncontrollability over medicines, and incredibilities or irresponsibilities in drug companies and fraudulences, and the repatriation of the diseases in spite of medication, insecurity in surgical and drug responses, all of these things has resulted in the formation of only a spiritual solace. Only God could save us and not a doctor and medicine. Either they can support, if I want to live, either God must support or he must be a substitute for the medicine. Either God must support the medicine and doctor, or totally I must be away from doctor and medicine so as that I can survive. There is a book written by a very famous person. He has written Death by Medicine. He has written lot of people dying only because of medicine, not by doctor. That's what I told on the medical seminar. I told when a patient was asked by some other patient, when the doctor is discussing with the prescription and other things, he told what is happening. The person was asked, what is happening there? 4 D's are discussing. Doctor, drug, disease and my destiny. They are discussing what to do with me. So this physical inability, that is the first reason. And second thing is mind. We are having workload. We are having lot of workload. We are having tension. And there is no process. There is no psychotropic drug which has given you proper solace or proper comfort. So the body, its deterioration is the first reason to approach India for spiritual solace. The second thing is the whole world is suffering due to tension. Each and every house has a psychopath and psychiatrist at US. And there is no proper harmony in the society at all. Growing mental diseases, mental tensions, continuous race in pursuit of wealth. In pursuit of wealth, compromising one's own health, spoiling one's own mind, not concentrating on the tools for developing mind, that has resulted in the formation of mind-related problems which has tempted the person to go for a paramaterial or supermaterial relief. That is the mind. The third thing is relations. There is no relation at all. There is no relation at all. Each and everybody, they live only with the 2 circumstances. The human beings, they live under only 2 circumstances. One, just as a security to the house, or one more member, instead of avoiding solitude, one more member is required in the house. They want somebody for taking care of the possessions in the house. One. Number 2, they are afraid that they must be alone in the household, for that there is some other person distinguishable from the pillar and concrete structure of the house. So this is how they are having. Second thing, for social show, they are having relations in which they behave like Tom and Jerry inside and behave like Sita and Rama outside. So there are no proper relations. What are the 6 major instincts which give you relations? There are 6 instincts which can give you relations. You must note down, certainly it is a way of life. Number 1, adjust. 2, agree. 3 is advise. 4 is forget. 5 is forgive. 6th thing is love. So love the other person, agree with some person on only agreeable conditions, agree with the person, adjust with the person. Agree is accepting, adjusting is not protesting, it is different. So agree with the person, adjust with the person, just to show your legal and reasonable intrusion for their betterment, that is known as advice. Forget something so that we can be happy, forgive something so that we can be happy, and love them so that they can be cured more by love. These 6 instincts are known as the greases of human mind. They are known as the greasy substances of human mind which reduces friction or which avoids friction in relations. That thing is not there. That's why there are only 2 options. You have to cry, you have to hug somebody and cry. You have to sleep in somebody's lap and you have to shower your joy. You have to speak with somebody. You have to burst your emotions to somebody. There are only 2 options in the society. One is GOD, second is DOG. So you have to wrap pets and you have to cry or you have to love with them. Second thing is you have to surrender to God and you have to submit to Himself. So this type of relations, mismanagement. So no person in the small age, by means of nutrition, physiological evolution, psychological status, they are not trained to get these six instincts. They must be given sattvic food, sattvic dhyana and practices. You are not giving anything. Then after the person is grown, why you are blaming that he is not taking care of me? Is there any parent or is there any couple, those who have trained the people by means of various samskaras or by puja vidhanas or dhyanas or by proper ahara diksha, that they will be very much affiliation, very much dependence, very much obedience, subservience, all of these qualities can be felt in later? So you have not sown any seed, what you can come for harvesting? So third thing is relation. Fourth thing is depletion of nature. So nature was told to be God. That is in depletion. So there is only one thing beyond depletion, that is a purna, complete God. So nature has also abandoned us. So we have to go beyond nature, paranatural dream. That is the instinct of God. And that is the force of the divine. So that is there. And the fifth thing is national and international issues. Global issues, even like terrorism, drug addiction, even global warming, and various other things are there pesting the society. These five things, because of the mind, because of the body, because of the relations mismanagement, because of the global issues, and because of the nature's repletion, we have no other go except to go for God. And for that, we have to go for spiritual lineage and scriptural lineage, Acharya Parampara and Shastra Parampara. Scriptural lineage and spiritual lineage, and the only place, only abode in the world where we can have uninterrupted, blemishless lineage of scripturalism and spiritualism is our land. So India Century Mission is justified. So apart from this, now the whole world, they have invented TV, they have invented plasma, they are going to Mars, they have done everything. But there are some instincts which have governed the present society. Everything has become very common and usual. Everything that was at the time of inceptive stage of inventions, whenever they are seeing TV, they saw like there is some alien. Seeing computers, seeing everything was considered to be something different, something great and something worthy of exclamation before a few centuries or few decades. Now we have seen everything. Everything has become very common, number one. Number thing, we have exhausted. Totally we have exhausted and we have been exhausted. But third thing, instead of getting an attractive dimension, now everything is giving a tedious and monotonous dimension. So first thing, everything has become common, and second thing, everything has become monotonous. The third thing, we have exhausted and we are totally frustrated and tired and seeing the developments, hearing these things. Our level of curiosity is subjected to the law of diminishing nature. Now it is dropping towards zero. At one stage we are going to totally dislike everything, and we are now developing an unintentional, unknowing, nostalgic sense to go back to our culture and tradition and heritage inside our mind. So unavoidably, whether you like it or not, all the computers will be replaced by portraits of gods. Our computers will have portraits of gods on them, on the desktop and screen top. There is no other option, because over exhaustion, monotonous way of these things, and also very commonality and casual way of viewing these things for several decades together, it has been progressed in such a manner that we have started hating it, or we have started to make a very casual and ordinary prosaic look on all of these things. And in ancient timings, the God or the system of our religion that taught only two ways of life. One, you enjoy the life, or you suffer for enjoying the life. There are only two things. One is enjoy. Second is to suffer by hard work, hard learning. Suffer, and then as a result of your suffering, just as a pregnancy is a pain and delivery is a pleasure. Surgery is a pain and relief or total recuperation of your health is the pleasure. So ancient system, they thought only two things. One, have pleasure by means of limited knowledge, limited execution, contentment and other qualities. The second thing is suffering. Through suffering you gain pleasure or be joyous. Now there are two systems. You suffer or you enjoy everything and suffer later. Only there are two systems now in the world. Enjoy everything in your younger age, IT industry, go work, get all money, and be a walking dog, a walking animal after your 40s, 50s, without any relations or without even relating to a relation, or without having the capability to relate yourself to the relations because of loss of your emotional values, because of your overinvestment in financial technicalities and mathematical analysis and computer system analysis. You have totally exhausted all of the possibilities of your valuable humanitarian instincts by which you can not even relate yourself to any relations. So this type of suffering, and be joyous for suffering the late. Now you have to enjoy everything, because you cannot enjoy in the later part of your life. So this is the present trend. So India has 5 things to teach to the globe. The first thing is refinement, sanskara. And the second thing is contentment, tripti. Third thing is sacrifice, tyaga. Fourth thing is integrity, aikya. Fifth thing is potence, shakti. The real shakti is saving others. It is not ambivalent, either to save others or to destroy others or destroy everybody and even the planet as a whole. It is not shakti. Shakti is a capability in which you can reconciliate even with your enemies. Ripunamapi vatsalaha. That is the greatest shakti that we have implanted in our holy land. So these 5 things are given by our land. If there is contentment, why you are going for advanced shift, then night shift, double shift, post shift, overseas job, why you are going for that? Because you don't have contentment. You have to see, whenever you see, there is a reasonable way of earning. Each and every penny that you are earning more than what you deserve, you can keep it with you, and with interest it is going to be spent for some other unnecessary thing. If you see, not in proper vyaya, it is going to be converted into vraya. So there is no other option. So contentment is a basic quality of life. Only our samskaras, they have given that. The first thing I have already is our samskara. That is garbhadana samskara, jata karma, annaprashana, karnavedi, chaula, chandra darshana, surya darshana, pitru darshana, nishkramana, alaya darshana, jihvalekana, aksharabhyasa, karnabhoda, upanayana, samavartana. Innumerable samskaras are there. These samskaras, they refine the human being to be a capable tool for the society. A real possibility, I told in one gynecology seminar, a person can be 99%, he can be under our control. Our child can be 99% under our control before conceiving by means of prayer. At the time of bearing them inside our body, 75% they can be controlled. At the time of their growing, since their birth to 1 year, they can be 50% controlled. Up to the age of 7, till they are getting that prajna, awakened prajna, they can be controlled 25%. Then everything is optional. Either they can control you or you can be a mute spectator. It can happen. So this samskara is only available in India, nowhere else in the world. How to qualify and how to refine these people? See, you are producing good gold. You are producing quality mechanisms. You are producing quality airplanes, quality trains, quality computers, high-end systems. But only people to produce quality people is our Indian culture. Who will produce quality Indians? Who will produce quality human beings? It is known as best breed. Even in poultry, they say that it is the best breed. For our eating, we are consuming. This is the best pork, this is the best beef, this is the best poultry. It is the best medicine. So in everything, we want something best. So the consumers, ourselves, we are best bred only by the system of Indian culture, the Indian system of philosophy, that is samskara. Second is tripti, third is tyaga. If a person is properly initiated and ignited at his before, that is pre-conceptible age, then at the time of the labor and the post, that is prenatal, natal and postnatal stages, by means of spiritual refinement, that a person will have tyaga, that a person will be having aikya, such a person will be having also that shakti. And that a person will be also having one more quality. It is known as health infection. It is not disease infection. He will be having a health infection, so that wherever such a person, samskrita person, wherever he goes, he will infect, he will be contagious by spreading his health, by spreading his spiritual prowess and progress. He will be totally infecting the society. That is a salubrious infection. So he will be a health infection agent, not a disease infection agent, just as we are reading in HIV, hepatitis B, this, that and everything, etc. So our stotras and our shatras and our shrutis, they proclaimed and prescribed such a system by which we can create not only a healthy person, but a person who can radiate the other components, other variables, other dependents, other associates and co-inhabitants of the society by getting the spiritual health transformed at ease. Now we are coming to the conclusion. Our India only has taught the whole world now yoga and Ayurveda. For physical salubrity, Ayurveda, and for mental precision and perfection, stabilization and tranquilization, they are teaching Ayurveda. So there is Yoga Shastra. Likewise, now we are having the universal system and its functions. Nobody can define what is evolution and what is creation. Our Indians, they are having the karmic cycle of intelligent design. How to interpret having something, and if you are going to die, that is not the end. That's what I told. Seers of the person, those who can see before your existence and those who can see even after your absence. Those who can see before your existence and after your absence, they are known as seers. Likewise, the karmic theory says that you have to live your principal life. If you are suffering, that is your previous cause. And if you are doing good, don't worry, it will be going to benefit you at your later time or your generation. So, a moral way of life, and for discovering the mysteries of the world, the karmic theory, which has created the creation, evolution, justification of goodness and evilness in the order, everything is governed only by the karmic theory. That is the contribution of only our country. And the third thing is multi-level knowledge systems. We have epistemology, knowledge-oriented things. Metaphysics, science about something which is indriyadita, that which is beyond the senses, indriyadita. That is known as metaphysics. We are having ontology, that is adhyatma mula shastra. Eschatology, that is mrti shastra, that which happens after death. We are having epistemology. Agathology, science of goodness and sin. We are having aritology, we are having thaumatology, we are having teleology, we are having geritism. We are having innumerable systems of knowledge, which when we are discussing these systems in a great advanced way of life, the whole society was uncivilized, nomadic and nude. So we are having such a rich treasure, and that must be re-implanted. Now we are coming to the stage of life in which I want to say some great things. First of all, you must understand there are five R's. One is routinal life. One is routine, what we call routine. And second thing is reward. That is the benefit of some of our activities, the fruits of our activities. It is known as like that. Third thing is recreation. Some way for soothing our mind. The fourth thing is retrogression. The unwanted things that intrude into your mind or physical body, that gives retrogression. The fifth thing is replantation or replenishment. That replenishment is also offered by the Vedas. So all these five things are controlled by our spiritual principles. Even taking bath, brushing your teeth are with mantras. What is science and what is spiritualism? That which sees even a mega event without any base is science. That which sees even a small notion and activity of human being with a great cause is known as spiritualism. You are brushing your teeth and you are thinking just we are brushing our teeth. It is teeth and it is a brush and it is a paste, nothing like that. So, Shastra says that there are innumerable devatas, energy or force implantations here. By qualifying those things for vak siddhi, for mantra, for gana, for uchharana, for bhasha patana, for kavitva rachana, innumerable things are inside. So they worship Vanaspati and they worship Saraswati and they do that. So everything is magnified in spiritualism. Does that even the routinal activities are considered to be divine services. Taking bath and going to saucha and doing small things which are just human instinctive and natural, very casual in the society, they are considered with great divine significance. So routinal activities are also divine. Reward activities like your occupation, rewarding activities like your occupation, business, everything, that is also considered to be divine. Recreative activities like literature, art forms, like music, like painting and drawing, then dance, then sculpture, everything was divine. Either God connected, godly, God represented, or divine strictly in nature. So our routine was God, and our recreation was God, and our reward was God. If we get retrogression, that is also due to God, because of not remembering Him. That's why great people told, there is only one sampatti to human being and only one vipat. To get the necessary thing is sampat. To get the necessary thing and not to get the unnecessary is sampat. To get something unnecessary and lose something that is necessary is known as vipat. And great people, they told, Vishnor Vismaranam Vipat Sampan Narayana Smritihi. So the retrogression is because of lack of proper contact with the divinity, the divine origination. So replenishment, for getting it back, we want to get with God. That is the school of thought of India, by which the routinal, the reward giving, as well as the replenishing and retrogressive, as well as the recreative systems, even time passing events are connected with God. Now we are having three problems. Ahoratra. Now it is night. For America, it is day. Likewise, we started with a very advanced civilization. Now we are in the night. And those people, they were nomadic tribes, and now they are in the daylight. They are in the progression of science, technology, richness, and they are teaching a lot of things to us. So it is known as Ahoratra Nyaya. Second thing is Gomamsa Nyaya. I want to say that Gomamsa Nyaya. What is Gomamsa Nyaya? See, if a cat is eating a mouse, then there is nothing wondrous. Deterioration is common to everybody, like waxing and wearing of moon. Indians being deplorable and despicable, it is like cow eating mamsa. Our country, to its heritage and the wealth status of its spiritual splendor, this deterioration, this type of what we call debilitation is something like cow is fed with mamsa. So anybody can be totally degraded. Degradation is the unavoidable component of birth. But Indians degrading is like a cow entangling into the process of something carnivorousness in nature. So Indians must be always a torchbearer and image model for the society. So you cannot say that the whole world is nonsensical, I am also nonsensical. Everybody is aberrant, I am also there. It is universal. We must not consider it to be universal. Because we were different and we are different. So we have to be different. That is the nature of our country. The third thing is parampara nyaya. How we can get this benefit? Somebody may ask the question. How we can have the benefit? We were having parampara. Now we are in the status of a declination. But our parampara was in the state of substandard settlement and superstandard settlement and standard settlement. Now only we are in this level. But before thousands of years, before millions of years, our elders were there who were greater in valor, greater in knowledge, greater in tapasya, austerity and penance, greater in realization and transmission. So we have got a parampara. Do the Western community get any parampara? To the Western community, now existing community, can you say that they have a parampara? They don't have any parampara. They are in the process of ascending order, coming from a system of nomadism. They are coming towards civilization. Whereas we were well civilized and we are in the status of cultural invasion and cultural debilitation. Now we are in the process of degradation. So what is the great benefit for us? We are having a parampara. The problem is we don't have a link with the parampara. We are having pitrarjita vastu. And Svayarjita is very limited. We are having Pitrarjita, which is very much augmented, which is collected, augmented, and extravagantly stored for our purpose and development by great rishis like Vaivasvata Swayambhuva, Atri Vishnu, Briddhaharita, Angira, Atharva, Apastamba, Bodhayana, Ranayaniya, Drakhyayaniya, Latyayaniya, Brihaspati, Parasara, Vyasa, Shakti, Shankalikita, Dakra, Gautama, Shatatapa, Prugu, Pulastya, Kanva, innumerable these seers, they have got the treasury of knowledge and we are having the parampara. Only thing is, we have to link with the main source. We are having 10,000 watts, they are having 2.5 watts battery, but they are linked due to which the torch is bearing. We are having a very big effulgence, but not linked with the power station. Our power station is the teachings of our ancestors, the lifetimes of our ancestors, the thoughts, the smriti and pujana. Thinking and worship, I have already told in a seminar, there are two forces or two methodologies. There are visible energies and invisible energy. How to get the visible energy? You have to work. How to get invisible energy? You have to worship. So work is the process to get visible energy. For example, if you have 5 acres of land, you must not go there and daily worship without doing any work. And in divinity, worship is the tool. And in materialism, work is the tool. So unite your work in materialism and worship in spiritualism. Relink yourself with the great effulgence of that multipotential transmitter of the divine radiation of the teachings, the lives and greatness of the people. Think them, worship them, imitate them, instill their ideas, inculcate in the modern society to your beloved people, your lovers, your followers and the other corresponding societies of memory. And also to create a very great drastic change in the society, a small spark that must be made and the area must be made combustible and the spark must result in a very blazing fire, totally eradicating the cloudy, murky sheets of India, reinstilling their glory, reinstilling the luminosity of knowledge and potency, once again rethroning India as a global leader. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.
Thank you, Swamiji, for your highly enlightened lecture on India's. Very grateful to you, Swamiji. And now it is time for us to give our Swamiji a standing ovation for his excellent speech. Thank you. Now it is getting late.